Hi, everybody. For this engagement check and the next one, we are going to be talking about fluids. And in particular, we're going to start by talking about fluids that are not in motion, what we call fluid statics. There are four states of matter. We have solids, liquids, gases, and plasmas. So as you apply heat to a system or energy to a system, you change the substance from a solid to a liquid, to a gas, and then to a plasma. So for example, water, if we think about water, in its solid state, water is ice. When you apply heat to ice, we know that it melts and it becomes a liquid. And then whenever you apply more heat, more energy to that liquid, it becomes a gas. And finally, if you have a gas, and you apply even more energy to it, it can become a plasma. So behind me, I have the sun. The sun is made up of plasma, hydrogen and helium gas, but that plasma, that gas is so hot, hot enough that some of the electrons can actually separate from orbiting around the nucleus. And then you have electrons that are free to move around freely within the fluid, okay? And whenever you stir up that fluid, you can generate electric fields and as a byproduct, a magnetic field. So that's how we think about the sun, and that's sort of the research that I did for my PhD too. I was talking about the sun's magnetism and the motion of the hot gas inside the sun, the motion of the sun's plasma generates electric fields and as a byproduct, magnetic fields. So I really like fluid dynamics. A fluid is any substance that flows, okay? Liquids can be fluids, gases can be fluids, plasmas can be fluids. Fluids take on the shape of their container, and plasmas, as I said, are fluids too. That's a stellar interior. Before we move on, let's talk about the difference between a compressible and an incompressible fluid. So as the name suggests, a compressible fluid is one in which the matter can be compressed with the application of an external pressure. And because we can compress that fluid, the volume can be reduced when you apply pressure, and the density can be reduced when you apply pressure. So standard air at room temperature, we can consider that to be a compressible fluid, okay? And then we think about incompressible fluids. These fluids are such that the matter cannot be compressed with the application of an external force. And because of this, the volume does not change. The volume cannot be reduced with the application of the pressure on the fluid, and the density cannot be changed with the application of a pressure on the fluid. So sometimes we take this approximation of incompressibility in order to help us solve some physics problems. So for example, in a lot of the problems I work with for the sun, it's easier to think about that problem as being an incompressible fluid versus a compressible fluid. And we'll take advantage of the fact that a lot of hydraulic fluids are incompressible in order to solve a few problems later. Another important thing that we need to understand for this chapter is density. Density is the ratio of the mass of an object to its volume. And we represent density as the Greek letter rho here, Greek letter rho. The density is equal to the mass divided by the volume. And the standard unit of density, the SI unit of density, is kilograms per meter cubed. But sometimes we use grams per meter cubed too. So, and also I don't really use this relationship too much, but maybe you might in chemistry. 1 milliliter is the same as 1 cubic centimeter. 1 liter is the same as 10^-3 meters cubed. So here's a table of a bunch of different densities for different substances. You can find similar tables in your textbook. We are gonna use a lot the density of water. The density of water is 1 gram per centimeter cubed or 1,000 kilograms per meter cubed. Here's a great example to talk about the difference between mass and density. Okay, so we saw similar problems like this we've got two masses on either side of a pivot point, okay? And in order for the system to be in equilibrium, the torque on the left has to equal the torque on the right, okay? And the force that's being applied here to create the torque is the weight of the object. The weight is equal to its mass times gravity, okay? So the weight of both of these objects are going to be the same. That means, if in order for us to be in equilibrium, that means the mass of both of these objects are going to be the same. That's our 1 ton of feathers and our 1 ton of bricks in this case. But we need to think about the density then. Okay, so the common thing is, which weighs more, 1 ton of feathers or 1 ton of bricks? Well, they both weigh the same, okay? But which one has the most density? Remember, density is the mass per volume. So over here, for both cases, we've got the same amount of mass, but the 1 ton of bricks occupies a smaller volume. So if you have the same mass divided by a smaller volume, you have a larger density. You have the same amount of mass, but compressed into a smaller volume. And in that case, your density is greater. Another concept we have to understand for this section is pressure. Pressure is the ratio of the force exerted to the area over which that force is exerted. So pressure is equal to force over area, or force per area. The units for pressure are what we call pascals, and they're abbreviated by PA, a name for a scientist, last name of Pascal. 1 pascal is the same as 1 newton over meter squared. And the pressure that we experience from the atmosphere at sea level is what we call 1 atmospheric pressure, or 1 atmosphere of pressure, and that's equal to 101,325 pascals, or 1.01 times 10 to the 5 pascals. A lot of physics textbooks will, at this point, break out the bed of nails experiment. And explain, why can you lay on a bed of nails and not get impaled? Well, if you put all of your weight, all of your mass times gravity, that's a force, onto one nail, you have a lot of force being exerted over the tiny cross-sectional area in point of that nail. So this area is small, but your force is large. And so you have a large amount of pressure, and that nail is gonna go right through your foot, right? But what if you take a board and you fill it with a whole bunch of nails? So you still have your weight, but you're going to be standing on a whole bunch of nails underneath your feet. So you increase the area over which your force is being applied. And so that's how the bed of nails experiment works, and how you can survive standing on or laying on a bed of nails. It's because you have the same force, but you're spreading it out over a larger area. Now, one other thing to remember is that fluids exert forces on the walls of air containers. So the fluid in the air in this room is exerting forces on the walls, and that fluid pressure pushes on all parts of the fluid itself. It forces the fluid out of a container with holes as well. So if you have, you've probably experienced this in your life, you have a cup of coffee and it gets a hole in it, and then that fluid's going to come out of the holes in that cup. The pressure from a fluid varies with depth. So you probably know this about the ocean, but the pressure at the very bottommost part of the ocean is much, much greater than the pressure is just a few meters underneath the ocean, okay? So the fluid density also determines the pressure inside a fluid at any particular depth. The pressure at the bottom of a container just from the liquid above it is equal to, well, the pressure is equal to the force over area. So the force is going to equal to the weight of all the fluids that's above you divided by the cross-sectional area, okay? And so we can rearrange the equation for density. Density is equal to mass over volume. Solve it for mass, and then we find that mass is also equal to density times volume. So you could replace this mass here with density times volume. So you have density, volume, gravity over the area that this force is applied equals, okay, well, volume. You can represent volume as a cross-sectional area times some height. So imagine you have a column of water. The cross-sectional area, like right here, the cross-sectional area of our column of water would be pi r squared, the area of this circle here. Then if we multiply that cross-sectional area by the height of that column, we get its volume. So we could represent the volume as a cross-sectional area times height. Okay, so we can swap that in there. All right, and then we see that area is on top of area, and so it cancels. So pressure is also, the pressure at the bottom of a container is also equal to the density of the fluid times gravity, or the acceleration due to gravity, times the height of that column of fluid that's above you. The total pressure at the bottom of a container, so let's say the pressure at the bottom of this container that we see here, that's P, will equal to what we call the atmospheric pressure, which is the pressure that's already existing above that column of liquid, plus the pressure from just the liquid itself, which is rho gh. So the pressure at the bottom of this cup of water is going to equal to our atmospheric pressure, the 1.01 times 10 to the 5 pascals, plus the density of water, or whatever fluid it is, times the acceleration due to gravity, times the height of this column of water. We are going to apply that principle to a fairly simple problem here. We're going to calculate the pressure created by layers of different fluids. So let's imagine we have a huge oil tanker. Salt water has flooded our oil tank to a depth of 0.5 meters. So here's our oil tank, okay, in this oil tanker. And water is sitting here to a height of 5 meters, okay? On top of the water is a layer of oil 8 meters deep. The oil has a density of 0.7 grams per cubic centimeter. Oil is always going to float on top of water. Why? Well, water has a density of 1 gram per cubic centimeter. Oil is less dense than water, so oil is going to float on top of any material that's more dense than it is. So that layer of oil is going to float on top of the water. And then we're going to find the pressure at the bottom of this oil tank, assuming there's also a layer of air at atmospheric pressure in the top of this tank. So we're going to have a layer of air at atmospheric pressure, then a layer of oil, and then a layer of water. And we're going to find the pressure right here at the bottom of this tank from all that stuff stacked on top of it. To find the pressure at the bottom of the tanker, we just have to add up the pressure from all the individual layers. So our total pressure is going to equal the pressure from our air on the top, which is at already at atmospheric pressure. So I'm going to write that as P sub naught, plus the pressure from our column or our layer of oil. And that's going to be the density of oil times gravity times the height of the oil layer, plus our pressure coming from the ocean layer. And that's going to be the density of our salt water times G times the height of that salt water layer. Okay, so we were given the density of our oil in 0.7 grams per centimeter cubed. That's the same as 700 kilograms per meter cubed. Okay, the density of ocean water is 1.025 grams per cubic centimeter, just a tiny bit more dense than regular water, and that's equal also to 1,025 kilograms per meter cubed. So we're just going to plug in here our atmospheric pressure from the air layer, 1.01 times 10 to the 5 pascals, plus our density of oil, which I'm going to use the 700 kilograms per meter cubed. Well, we're going to be multiplying by our gravity, which is 9.8 meters per second squared. So I want to be in units of meters for sure. And then we have to multiply by my height of the oil layer, 8 meters, plus the density of our salt water. We're going to go 1,025 kilograms per meter cubed times 9.8 meters per second squared times the height of that layer, 5 meters. And so then adding up the pressure from all those three layers, we find that the total pressure at the bottom of our tank here is 2.06 times 10 to the 5 pascals. All right, so that's almost twice that of atmospheric pressure, the pressure that we feel just sitting here at sea level. We're going to apply those ideas of the variation of pressure with depth to this problem right here, and this is going to be your question below for the engagement check. Where is the pressure at the bottom of the container the greatest for each of these three containers? Rank these scenarios from the greatest pressure at the bottom of the container to the least amount of pressure, okay? So we have containers A, B, C, and D. You're going to figure out what is the pressure at the bottom of each of these containers from the layer of fluid above them and also from some layer of gas above them that's already at some pressure, okay? So P sub zero we could think of as the pressure, the atmospheric pressure, that's our 1.01 times 10 to the 5 pascals. So here at the top of our container, we have a layer of one atmosphere, a layer of one atmosphere, a layer of one atmosphere, and then a layer of two atmospheres. And in three of these, we have one layer of liquid, but the density could be different. And in this one here, we have two layers of liquid, each with a different density. So you're gonna rank these containers from the greatest pressure at the bottom to the least amount of pressure at the bottom.